Good morning, friends.
Good morning, sir.
Okay, let's start with a new area today. So we'll start with investment decision. In the last class, you would have learnt about time value of money. Just a minute. Okay, in the last class, we learnt about time value of money, which indicated that the value of the money does not remain constant. The value of the money will keep changing with the time. Now, what is capital budgeting? Is capital budgeting basically means budgeting for a capital expenditure. What do you mean by capital expenditure? What is capital expenditure? Yeah. What do you mean by capital expenditure? Okay, more than 1 year. Then what else? Involves large amount of
cash.
Okay, anything else? Yeah, so broadly this is the thing. Your capital expenditure is something which will involve large outflow of money. From an analysis point of view, what happens is it will involve a huge outflow of cash today. It will involve a huge outflow of cash today to get a series of inflows. You'll be getting inflows across the life of the project. So when the project is going on, so I may construct a building today. Today I may spend 20 crores on the building, but every year I'll keep earning rent. So a capital expenditure is one which involves a huge outflow of cash today in anticipation of series of cash inflows across the life of the project. More than 1 year definition may not work from an FM point of view. In FM, what matters is how material is the expenditure, how material is going to be the expense. So for a company like Tata Consultancy Services, even 1 crore expenditure is not going to come under the purview of capital budgeting, because for them 1 crore is an insignificant amount. For a smaller company, even 10 lakhs can become a significant amount. For us, even 1,000 or 1 lakh can become a significant amount. So it all depends on the materiality of the company. There are certain principles in capital budgeting which needs to be followed. When do you follow them is wherever it is a material amount for the company. So capital budgeting means budgeting for capital expenditure. A capital expenditure is one which involves a huge outflow of cash today in anticipation. I anticipate something in anticipation of a series of cash inflows. So you'll be getting a lot of cash inflows across the life of the project. This is what broadly the capital budgeting is all about. Your capital budgeting means you budget for the capital expenditure. Why do I budget for the capital expenditure? It's too huge amount for me to fail. So if you are buying something worth 1 lakh rupee, let's assume you have to buy some product worth 1 lakh rupee. The kind of research which you will do to buy that 1 lakh will be significantly higher than buying something worth 1000 rupees or 100 rupee. If you have decided to go on a trip worth 1 lakh rupee, you may not get the quotation from only one travel agent. You may do a lot of research, try to get quotation from 3-4 travel agents. You yourself try to build a travel package. You do all of this because 1 lakh is a significant amount for you. Similarly, for companies, it can be 10 lakhs, crore, 10 crore, anything which is huge, anything which is huge. What is huge depends on person to person, company to company. So something can be material for me, maybe immaterial for you. Something can be immaterial for you or material for you can become immaterial for me. So it all depends on whether the amount is material or not. Wherever it is material, you will have to go through series of steps. That's what we are going to learn. So any capital expenditure I do, it has to be put on to series of steps before going ahead with that expenditure. I cannot randomly go ahead with an expenditure without doing any kind of research on it. Now, what is the kind of research I do? You have, would have done, you think about anything which you have bought more than 40,000, 50,000. Could be a television, could be a mobile phone. Even for a mobile phone worth 10, 15,000, you will do a lot of research, a lot of analysis. Try to find which is the best fit. From where do I buy? Do I buy online? Do I buy offline? All of that is done. You try to get feedback from few people and then only you go ahead with your decision. That is what investment decision all says. Investment decision says you cannot make random investments. You will have to do some bit of analysis, some bit of research, and then do the capital expenditure. The reason for this is all of this. it's a substantial expenditure. So it's a huge amount. I cannot go ahead and invest randomly a huge amount. It is for a long time period. It's going to impact for a longer period. Most of your capital budgeting decision are irreversible. When I say irreversible, if you bought your television worth 60,000, you cannot go ahead and randomly change it again after 10 days saying that I don't want this television, can you give it back? So it is mostly an irreversible decision, and it's a complex decision. Complex decision is a lot of analysis has to be done. Now, the first part of any capital budgeting problem is you have to start with estimating the cash flows of the project. So any problem, our starting point is getting the cash flows of a decision. Now, when we do a decision worth 50,000, 60,000, we see only outflow. What is the inflow? Inflow is an intangible item. What is an intangible item? The comfort which you get, or the relaxation which you get by going on a trip, or with the television, the entertainment which you get. All of this I cannot value in terms of monetary terms. Those are things which can't be valued in terms of monetary. Whereas when any corporate does a project, there are going to be benefits because of the project, and these benefits are something which can be valued in terms of money. We can go ahead and value the benefits in terms of money. So this is what we are going to start with. How do you go ahead with a capital budgeting decision? And the starting point for that is cash flows, getting the cash flows. Now, any area in finance focuses only on cash flow. We don't focus on profits. Your financial management techniques never place any emphasis on profits. Why I don't emphasize on profits? What is the problem if I emphasize on profits? We are not bothered about profits. We are bothered only about cash flow. Why no profits? What is the problem with profits? Any idea? The emphasis is only on cash flow, never on profits. No, but profits is going to impact your cash flow. Profits? It will not be cash, that's okay. But why no profit? See, to a great extent, profits will influence your cash flow. But why people don't impact profits is, profits is one accounting aspect. When I say accounting aspect, suddenly I do an analysis and I say project is getting rejected. After the project is getting rejected, the accountant says, let's change the SLM to WDV. Let's change SLM to WDV. You start finding that the project is successful now. Or no provision for bad and doubtful debts. Let's value the stock at FIFO method, not LIFO method. Let's value at weighted average method, not LIFO method, not FIFO method. So normally there is a saying that if I give financials to 10 different accountants, they may come with a 10 different profits. The reason for 10 different profits is you can follow FIFO method vis-a-vis weighted average method. You provide for provision for depreciation. Sorry, you provide depreciation under WDV method, SLM method. So you have different possible ways in which the profits can undergo a change, but cash flows is never subjective. Anything, everyone has to give you the same amount of cash flows. Your cash flows cannot undergo change just because of your accounting issues. So that is why people prefer cash flow vis-a-vis profits. Finance entirely talks about cash flow rather than profits, because profits is something which is highly subjective in nature. If at all I need, I can change the profits by just making a small adjustment. Cash flows can't be changed. Clear? Any doubts on this? Now, cash flow statements done for you? Done? You would have learnt about direct method, indirect method there. Okay. Now, taking that into consideration, now when I do cash flow analysis, I will have two ways of getting my cash flow. First way is preparing a receipt and payment account. In a receipt and payment account, you will start with inflows, all inflows you will write, all outflows you will write, and the net cash flow is calculated. So that is one way of doing the problem, which is something we will never solve in any exam problem because you will not be given that much information. So this is from a practical point of view. From a practical point of view, you can go ahead and do something called as a receipt and a payment account, receipts and payments account are a cash flow statement. Yeah, sorry, are a cash account. If you have a cash and bank account, all inflows will come, all outflows will come. Net net, you get to know whether there is an inflow of cash or an outflow of cash. So this is one approach. The second approach is from P&L. You start with P&L. You would have learnt about a direct method and an indirect method. In an indirect method, you start with some items from P&L, adjust for working capital changes, adjust for non-operating items, all of that you do, and you get the cash flow from operations or cash flow from operating activities. That's what you do in cash flow statement. So I can either start from a, I can do it from a receipt and payment account or from a P&L account. For problem solving purpose, it's entirely going to be from P&L. Now what you do from a P&L is, the format is already there, you just listen to it. You will start with revenues. Revenues is the starting point, less all cost other than depreciation. Why I say other than depreciation is a non-cash item, that's the understanding. There can be other non-cash item, you ignore all of that. All cost other than depreciation. You deduct this, you get PBDT, profit before depreciation and taxes, less depreciation, PBT less tax, PAT, add back depreciation, and you will get the cash flow after tax. So this is the format we use. You start with revenues, it's in page 26, you start with revenues, deduct all cost other than depreciation, you get profit before depreciation and tax, deduct tax, deduct depreciation, PBT, deduct tax, PAT, add back depreciation, CFAT. After that, there are few adjustments, this I'll do later on when I go to a comprehensive problem. This is how you calculate cash flow after tax. Any problem on capital budgeting, the start point is getting the cash flows. After getting the cash flows only, you can do all other analysis. If you don't have cash flows, you cannot do anything in a capital budgeting problem. Clear? Any doubts in this? Now, I have few pointers here. When you solve a problem, the problem can give information wherein you have revenues. Wherein you have revenues. Some problems, revenues may not be possible, then you may start with PBDT. The question will say the company is making the following profit before depreciation and tax. Then this format is flexible. It need not start with revenues. Sometimes it can start even with PBDT. Sometimes it can even start with PBT. It can even start with PBT. Sometimes it can even start with PAT. And sometimes the CFAT itself can be directly given. So it's a kind of a flexible format. I cannot say where will you start with. You may start with revenues, you may start with PBDT, you may start with PBT, you may start with PAT, or you may be given the CFAT itself in the question. So it can happen in any of the ways. You start either with revenues. Revenues is the best thing to start with. If not available, PBDT. Not available, PBT. Not available, PAT. Not available, CFAT could be directly given. Clear? Any doubts on this? Now, my next question is, why do I deduct depreciation and add back depreciation? What is the use of deducting and adding back? If I'm adding back, why should I deduct it? You went to the right direction, but no reserve future and all. Think about it and let me know. Why should I deduct depreciation and add back again? It's predominantly because of tax calculation. That's all. There's no other thing called as provision reserve and all. I have to calculate taxes. When I calculate tax, your PGBP allows depreciation as an allowable expense. So because of that, I deduct it and then add it back. That's the only reason. I don't have any other reason. There can be a problem where taxes are to be ignored. If that is the case, this PBDT which you see now is technically CFAT. Why technically CFAT? You will not deduct depreciation and add back depreciation. No tax is there. anyway taxes are not there. So from PBDT you deduct depreciation and get PBT, which I'm not going to do. There is no tax, so I'm not going to do that also. So PBDT will become CFAT. Clear? Any doubts on this? The predominant reason of doing a depreciation adjustment is only tax. In case the problem says taxes are to be ignored, or we don't have adequate information, or where we can assume that taxes are zero, in all that scenario, I am not going to calculate depreciation. Because depreciation calculation is of no use. Depreciation purpose is to calculate tax. And if that itself is not there in the question, what am I going to do here? Clear? Any doubts on this? Done? So this format, what is the starting point of the format? Revenues less all please participate, less all cost other than depreciation, you get PBDT less depreciation PBT less tax PAT add back depreciation CFAT cash flow after tax. Let's do question number one. Okay, ABC is evaluating the purchase of a new project with a depreciable base of rupees 1 lakh, expected economic life of 4 years and earnings before tax depreciation. Assume SLM and a 30% tax rate. You are required to compute the cash flows of the company. This is just to get to use, just to get used to the format. These and all will not come in exam. Just to get used to the format of calculating cash flow. Let's start. How many years is the project? Particulars and 4 years. Particulars and 4 years. Particulars and 4 years. What's the starting point of the question? Do we have revenues in the question?
No.
No. Do we have PBDT?
Yes.
Do we have PBDT? What is the question saying? Yes. Earnings before taxes and depreciation. So that is technically called as profit before depreciation and taxes, or earnings before depreciation and taxes. So write PBDT. Profit before depreciation and tax. Write the full name. Profit before depreciation and tax. Profit before depreciation and tax. What's the amount? Year one? 45,000. Year two, 30,000. 30,000. 25,000. 45, 30, 25 and 35,000. Less. What do we deduct? Depreciation. What's the cost of the asset? 1 lakh. Any salvage value? No. 1 lakh divided by 4. You get PBT. 20,050 and 10,000 from PBT. What's the tax rate?
Less tax at
taxes applied on the profits which you have made, tax at 30%. So on 20,000 you'll have to apply this tax at 30%. How much? 6,000, 1,500, 0 and 3,000. Let me know in case there are doubts anywhere. You get PAT. PAT is 14,000, 3,500, 0 and 7,000. Any doubts on this? Then add back depreciation. Let me know in case there are doubts here. Clear? Can we? Any doubts on this? Anyway, this is a simple thing just to understand the format. It's not a critical problem or something. Just to understand the format, we have done this. Any doubts on this? Can we proceed? Clear? Now, in order to do a capital budgeting problem or even in a practical world, I will need something called as a cash flow structure of the decision. For example, it's like this, year cash flow. I have decided to build a new plant in Chennai. So a factory is going to be set up. Year zero, 100 lakh outflow, 100 lakh, year 0 means today I have to spend 100 lakh outflow. First year, negative 10 lakhs. Why negative? I'm going to report losses and even in cash there is going to be loss. So first year, negative 10. Year 2, 40. Year 3, 50. Year 4, 60. Year 5, 40. That's all, the project is over. This is the starting point of doing a capital budgeting problem. You need year and cash flow. What is the year and a cash flow structure for a question? Initial outflow, how much are we spending? This 10, negative 10, 40, 50, 60 is like we calculated the CFAT. After getting the cash flows, so initially we are going to solve problem where the cash flows will be given and you understand how do you interpret those and understand about the various techniques. Later on, the problem focus itself will be to calculate the cash flow. How are you going to get the cash flows of the project? So once the cash flows are given, mostly now problems which we are going to do, the cash flows will be given. Now, after looking at this, I need to decide whether to do a project or not. So there are certain techniques which are there to decide whether to do project or not. The first technique is payback method. The first technique is how payback period is calculated. Now, the first technique is payback method. I'll first explain it. Payback means getting my money back. That's all. Payback means getting my money back. So, I have given some money to the project and I have to get back that money. That is called as payback. Clear? Any doubts on this? Payback refers to the number of years in which I get back the amount which I invest. For example, in this question, how much is the money we invested initially? 100. Recovery till now is negative 10. First year I am recovering negative 10. Second year put together my recovery is 30. Negative 10 plus another 40. Then my put together recovery is 80. Then my recovery is 140. So somewhere in between third and the fourth year I get back the money which I invest. I get back the money which I invest. So that's what payback says. Payback says number of years in which you recover the amount of money which has been invested. Clear? Now, last chapter you learned that cash flow of year 1, year 2, year 3, year 4 cannot be added. They cannot be added. Payback says you can add it. Later on you will understand something called as discounted payback, which says you cannot add it. You will have to bring it to the present value and then only do addition or subtraction, whatever you want to do. So payback does not consider the earlier concept called as time value of money. It ignores time value of money. Same payback, you will learn it as discounted payback, which considers the time value of money. So there are two payback techniques. One is normal payback. Second is discounted payback. Normal payback says you can add first year cash flow with the second year cash flow with the third year. Discounted payback says you cannot add all of them. You have to bring them to the present value, today's value, and then only you should do addition or deletion. Clear? Any doubts on this? So payback refers to the number of years. There's a formula. All of this I'll explain with the question, how you use the formula and all. Basic thing is, it ignores time value of money. The most critical part is it will ignore time value of money. So we will start with payback calculation for question number 2. I'll do it for one project, you will do it for the second project. Then we come back to the second technique. I discuss the second technique, again go back to the problem. I'll do it for one project, you will do it for the other project. Clear? So let's move to question 2. A company has to make a choice between two projects, namely A and B. The initial capital outlays are given. There will be no scrap value. Opportunity cost of capital. The cash flows are as under. Year, project A, project B, discounting factor. You are required to calculate for each project payback, discounted payback, ARR, NPV, profitability index. Some other information is there. Let's first go through the question and then we start doing this. Okay, coming to project, what is the initial outflow for the project? 135,000 is the initial outflow. I'll discuss only on project A. I'll give project B to you in some time. You will end up doing project B. So 135,000 is the initial outflow. The table, whatever is given, is it cash flow, PBDT, PAT, what is it? Cash flows are as under. Some problem will say, the PBDT is as under. If PBDT is as under, then I'll do PBDT less depreciation, PBT less tax, PAT add depreciation, CFAT, and then only I'll be able to do my analysis. So the question may give any information which they want to. Here we have the cash flows. Working note 1, calculation of payback. Calculation of payback. Now, when we solve a problem, all the techniques, when you write year, it will start with year 0 except for one technique, which is ARR. So it will always start with year 0. Why year 0? To write the initial outflow of the project. So now write year You will require 5 columns, okay, totally. Year. Now listen. You listen for some time, I will tell you to write. Project A will have 2 sub-columns. Cash flow, cumulative cash flow. Project B, this is something which you will do. Cash flow and cumulative cash flow. Listen for some time, I will tell you to note it down. So year, Project A will have 2 sub-columns. Cash flow and cumulative cash flow. Project B will also have 2 sub-columns. Cash flow and cumulative cash flow. My starting year is always year 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. What is the initial outflow for project? 1 lakh. That will come in negative in brackets. Whatever is your initial outflow will come in brackets because that's the money which you spend on day 0. Year 1, what do you get? 0. Okay. Year 2? 30,000. Year 3? 1 lakh? 32,000. Year 4? 84,000. Year 5? This is the cash flow given in the question, or you may have to compute. Now, cumulative cash flow is the cumulative value of the cash flow column. Cumulative value, that is first year negative 135. Then it is negative 135 plus 0. Negative 135 plus 0, it becomes negative 135. Negative 135 plus 30,000. Negative 1,05,000. Negative 105 plus 132. How much? 27,000. 27 plus 84. 1 lakh. 111 plus 84. Now, when you see the CCF column, whenever it becomes positive, CCF, okay? Cumulative cash flow, wherever it becomes positive, there your payback will be. Your payback would have been in between year 2 and year 3. Exact answer is through a formula. I'll come to that in some time. But your payback is going to be between year 2 and year 3. Why between? Because you had invested 135, 30,000 came, another 132 came, 162. You have recovered your investment. You have recovered your investment. So the cumulative cash flow, when it becomes positive, it means you have recovered the money which you have invested. Any doubts on this? You have recovered the money which you have invested. Clear? Any doubts on this? Do this table for project A as well as project B. How to get payback, I'll explain in some time. Can you proceed? Done. Okay, now listen. Payback equal to, this is the formula, base year plus, it's covered in the theory part, listen for some time, unrecovered cash flow of base year divided by cash flow of next year. I'll explain the logic in some time. Base year refers to the last year in which cumulative cash flow is negative. Year 0, is the cumulative cash flow negative for project A? Year 1 negative? Please participate. Year 1 negative? Year 2 negative? Year 3? Positive. So base year is year 2. Last year in which cumulative cash flow is negative. Wherever you see the negative answer, that is your base year. Last year in which cumulative cash flow is negative. Unrecovered cash flow base year means how much negative you could see in that year. What is the negative amount? 1 lakh. Divided by next year is the third year. What is the cash flow of the third year? 1 lakh. Now the logic behind this formula is in year 2, you are yet to recover 1,05,000. In the third year, you have got 1,32,000. So 1,05,000 by 132 will tell you the proportionate year. 1,05,000 divided by 132 will tell you the proportion of the year by which you get your money back. 105 by 132 is how much? 0.7955 years OR. We don't leave it like this. We do what? 2 years, and this decimal part alone you'll multiply with 12. Why with 12? To get it in months. 2 years and 9.5 months. The answer is 2 years and 9.5 months. The decimal portion alone will be multiplied with 12, not the entire portion. If you multiply the entire portion with 12, you'll get entire answer in months. So it will be 33 months or something. That is what you will get. So 2.7955 years OR, 2 years and 9.5 months. Any doubts on this? Now, when it comes to project B, I'm not going to apply any formula. The straightaway answer is year 3, because it's exactly becoming a zero. There, it exactly becomes zero in year 3. So straight away the answer is 3. Even if you apply the formula, it will become 2 plus 96,000 by 96,000. 2 plus 96,000 unrecovered cash flow of base year divided by cash flow of next year. 2 plus 96 by 96, you will get 2 plus 1, 3 years. Clear? Any doubts on this? Do it for project A now. For project B, it's going to be straight away 3 years. There's no calculation, anything to be done, because that exactly becomes zero. So for the second project, the payback is 3 years. Any doubts on this? Then I'll move to the second technique. Any doubts on this? Can we proceed? Okay, now we have calculated payback for project A, project B. Project A is 2 years, 9.5 months. Project B is 3 years. Now the company is asking, which is a better project? How will you choose? Between two projects, how do you choose a better project according to payback? Which has? I'm not able to hear anything. So which has what? Which has a lower payback period. Whichever has a lower payback period, that is what is going to be preferred. Any doubts still? No. So between two projects, I'll select a project which has a lower payback period. Great. You don't have two projects, you have only one project, project A. Project A's payback is 2 years, 9.5 months. Now they are asking, decide whether should I go ahead with project A or not. Only project A. You don't have any comparable project. It's only 2 years, 9.5 months. How do you decide then? There's only one project, 2 years, 9.5 months. You need to, so this is called as, see, there is something called as a decision rule and a choice rule. Choice rule is between two projects, select a project which has lower payback. That is when you make a choice, that's technically called as choice rule. Decision rule is how do you decide whether to take up a project or not. Project A, 2 years, 9.5 months. How do I decide? Should I go ahead, not to go ahead? Cash inflows? No, how will you, why will you check increase in cash inflows every year? There's an answer. I have given you an answer. Payback is 2 years, 9.5 months. With this, tell me. I don't want you to look at anything else. No discounting, only payback. Normal payback, 2 years, 9.5 months. With this, I want an answer, that's all. 2 years, 9.5 months. I'm not even talking about anything else. The question says, the company has a payback of 2 years, 9.5 months. Select, please advise whether the project can go ahead. Nothing else. You don't have any other information, okay? Don't get me into cash flow, initial outflow. Nothing is there. Discount rate, all of that is not there. Only information you have is 2 years, 9.5 months. Okay, there'll be something called as a target payback for the company. Look at the question, they would have mentioned a target payback. What have they mentioned? How much? 3 years. If my payback is below target payback, I will go ahead. That's all. If my payback is below target payback. So 2 years, 9.5 months is an acceptable period because target payback is 3 years. So there are two types of rules. Let me see whether I've covered it here. It's written here. Accept rule and choice rule. Accept the project if its payback is less than target payback. Choice rule, accept the project which has lower payback period. Accept the project which has lower payback period. Any doubts in this? What was the target payback in this question?
3 years.
Any doubts till now? Okay, now my next question. You do the calculation, project A payback is 3.5 years. Accept, reject. Reject, okay. Project A and project B. Project A 3.5 years, project B 4 years. Which project is to be taken up? A 3.5 years, B 4 years. Which one to be taken up? Project? I'm not able to hear. You participate. I want everyone's participation. Project A, project B? It's neither A nor B because both are rejected, first of all. They are not at all an acceptable project. When I have an acceptable project, only choice comes into picture. These two projects got rejected at the stage of target payback itself. They have got rejected at the stage of target payback. A choice can be made only when you accept them. If you have already rejected them, what is the concept of a choice? There is no concept of a choice to be taken. So both do not even figure it out in the choice part. Clear? Any doubts in this? Any doubts in this? So the first thing is I need to check whether a project is acceptable or not. It is not selecting worst of the best of the worst. So we are not going to do that way, saying that two worst projects are there, between them can I select a better project? That's not the decision we are taking. First, I have to be certain that it is a right project. After ascertaining that it is the right project, if you have multiple good projects, then to select, your choice rule will come into picture. So first you accept the project and then come to choice. If you have not accepted the project, there is no concept of a choice coming into picture. Clear? Any doubts in this? Any doubts? A choice can come into picture only if the project is accepted. If the project gets rejected at the first stage itself, I do not have any concept of a choice. Clear? Any doubts on this? Done. I'll go to the next technique then. Next is accounting rate of return. Now, what does accounting rate of return says is? Accounting is always related to profits. That's what accounting understands. So, accounting is related to profits. For return, return on investment or return, anything you calculate, the basic formula is what I get divided by what I invest. That's the formula for your return. If you have invested 1 lakh rupee and you earn a return of 10,000, you call it as 10%. How 10%? What I get is 10,000. What I invest is 1 lakh. 10,000 on 1 lakh is 10%. So what I get is profit. What I invest is investment. When I say investment, 1,35,000, 1 lakh, 2,40,000 for the two projects which we saw. So the formula for accounting rate of return is average PAT. Average PAT. Average PAT is average of the 5 years PAT divided by average investment or initial investment. Average investment or initial investment is very simple, 1,35,000 and 2,40,000 for the two scenarios. Average investment is opening plus closing by 2. Opening investment is what you invest on day 0. Closing investment is technically called as scrap value. Technically called as scrap value. In case there is no scrap value, closing investment is 0. Then automatically your average will become half of opening. Average will become half of opening. So average is opening plus closing by 2. So 2 formula, you call it as ARR on initial investment. That's the term you use. ARR on initial investment is equal to average profit by initial investment. ARR on average investment is equal to average profit by average investment. These are the 2 terms you use. ARR on initial investment, ARR on average investment. On initial investment is average profit by average initial investment. ARR on average investment is average profit by average investment into 100 to get the answer in percentage. Clear? Any doubts on this? Now, to solve a problem, we will use this format. Now, this is the only technique where the calculation will start from year 1. It's not going to start from year 0 because I cannot have a profit or a loss for a single day. So this is the only format which will start with year 1. You will write the cash flow. From cash flow, should I deduct depreciation to get PAT or add depreciation? From cash flow to PAT, we will have to deduct depreciation and get the PAT. You will put a total of the PAT and take an average of it. That's called as average PAT. Clear? Any doubts on this? Working note 2, calculation of ARR. Totally, you'll require 7 columns. Now write year. Project A with 3 subcolumns: cash flow, depreciation, PAT. Cash flow depreciation PAT. Project B, cash flow depreciation PAT. Project A, cash flow depreciation PAT. Project B, cash flow depreciation and PAT. In here you will write you will start with year 1. The starting is year 1, no year 0, because I cannot have a profit or a loss for a single day. What's the cash flow? Year 1 was 0. Year 2, 30,132.84. Can you tell me the depreciation per annum for project A? How much? Why 25? 20. Cost minus salvage value by life, 135 minus 0 by 5 years. There is no scrap value given in the question. So 135 minus 0 by 5 years, which is 27,000. PAT is, year one, what is the PAT? Negative 27, it's a loss. Negative 27,000. $1,95,000. That's the total profits for 5 years. $1,95,000. Then do it for project B and get the overall number.
was the overall profit?
$195 and $192. Can you proceed? Any doubts on this? Clear? Now come down.
ARR on initial investment is equal to
ARR on initial investment is equal to
average PAT by initial investment into 100.
Average PAT by initial investment into 100. Average PAT by initial investment into 100.
Project A, 195,000 divided by 5.
195,000 divided by 5. That is your average PAT. Whole divided by what is the initial investment? 1 lakh into 100. How much? 28.88%. Then project B. Project B. How much? Project A is 28.88. Project B is 16%. Any doubts on this? Clear? Now I'll then go to average investment. Any doubts on ARR on initial investment? 28.88% and 16%. Can we? Then ARR on average investment equal to ARR on average investment equal to
average PAT by average investment into 100.
Average PAT by average investment into 100. Now listen, project A will be 39,000 divided by opening is 135, closing no salvage value given in the equation, plus 0 divided by 2. It will automatically become half of your opening investment, 135 plus 0 by 2 into 100 to get the answer in percentage. 135 plus 0 by 2. Project B is 38,400 First one is 57.78%, the second one is 32%. Done. Any doubts on this? Can we? Now, again, when it comes to ARR, between two projects, I'll select a project which has higher ARR, because higher ARR means better return. For a single project, how you decide is if the ARR is higher than the target ARR, there will be a target ARR. Like you have a target payback, there will be a target ARR, and they have to make it very clear saying that it's target ARR computed on average investment or target ARR computed on initial investment, whatever be it. So there will be a target ARR on average investment or on initial investment, and that target ARR is what is going to be used. Clear? Any doubts on this? Target ARR on average investment or target ARR on initial investment, and then we make the decision whether to go ahead with the project or not. This is what we have seen till now. Accept the project if its ARR is higher than target ARR. Accept the project which has higher ARR. And obviously, first it has to be an acceptable project. The formulas are here. Average PAT by initial or average investment. You can use initial investment or average investment. Two different answers will be there. Initial investment is initial outflow. Average investment is average of initial outflow and salvage value. Clear? Any doubts on this? Next comes discounted payback. Same what you have learnt in payback. The formula is also same, just that it will become base year plus unrecovered discounted cash flow of base year divided by discounted cash flow of next year. You'll have to attach the word discounted. That's the only difference. So it's covered here. Base year plus unrecovered discounted cash flow of base year divided by discounted cash flow of next year. The calculation will again start with year zero. You will have to do the discounting of cash flows. After doing the discounting of cash flows only, you will be in a position to arrive at the decision. Clear? Let's do that question. Next, calculation of discounted payback. Next working note. Calculation of discounted payback. Now, let's do for one project and then we come to the next one. It'll require five columns for a single project itself. So, let's do one project and then you do the second one. Now, write year, cash flow, PVF, year, cash flow, PVF, DCF and CDCF. Year, cash flow, PVF, I'll explain this as I do it. Year, cash flow, PVF, DCF and CDCF. PVF is present value factor, DCF is discounted cash flow, CDCF is cumulative discounted cash flow. There would have been some discount rate given in the question, or cost of capital, what they mentioned. How much, what is the rate? So you'll write PVF at 16%. Write it as PVF at 16%. PVF at 16%. Now let's start. Year will start from year 0. Year and cash flow copy paste. Starts from year 0. What's the cash flow? How much? 1,35,000. 0. 30,000, 1,32,000, 84 and 84. Now, cash flows at different points of time can't be added. You cannot add or deduct them as our understanding. Now, what we do is we will discount all these cash flows to year zero. That is, you will bring down all the cash flow to year zero. So, when you are discounting this cash flow, you have to discount with 1 plus r square because 2-year factor. This has to be 1 plus r cube. This has to be 1 plus r power 4, 1 plus r power 5. So, it will be like this, 30,000 into 1 divided by 1 plus r square. When you divide, you are doing discounting. Into 1 divided by 1 plus r cube. Into 1 divided by 1 plus r power 4. Now, what we do is we get all of this in the calculator. In the calculator, for year 0, the factor is always 1. 1 divided by 1.16. 1 divided by 1.16. This will be the first year factor. I'm not noting down. I'll tell you why I'm not noting down. This will be the first year factor. Is this number matching with 0.862? Yes. Given in the question. Second year factor 0.743. Yes. Third year factor 0.641. Equal to, you'll keep putting an equal to. 1 divided by 1.16 equal to first year factor, equal to second year factor, equal to third year factor, equal to fourth year factor, equal to fifth year factor. Now, I'm not writing whatever I have done in the calculator, I'll exactly write the same numbers. Sometimes in a rounding off issue, you may, instead of writing 0.641, you will write 640. All of those issues are to be avoided. So, we will exactly copy the factor value given in the question. Most of the question, this will not be given. They will not give you the factor value. And it's not a difficult exercise. 1 divided by 1.16 equal to first year, equal to second year, equal to third year, equal to fourth year, equal to fifth year, discounting, time value of money, whatever we have learned. Let's copy the same factor as given in the question, 0.862. Now, any doubts till now? Now, the cash flows at different points of time can't be added. That was our basic understanding. So, to make them addable, I'm going to multiply with this. When you multiply with this, the DCF is basically today's value of all the cash flow. Year 5 cash flow of 84,000 is not 84,000. The worth of that is only 84,000. Into 0.476. So, the worth is only 39,984 rather than being 84,000. So, 84,000, when we did payback, we just kept on adding it. Discounted payback says nothing doing. You cannot add it like this because the worth is not 84,000. The worth is only 84,000 into 0.476. Whatever we have learnt in time value of money, exactly the same thing has been learnt under time value of money. Now, do the multiplication. You can round off if at all, anywhere rounding off is to be done. Clear? Now, if you look at 84,000, it has come in year 4 as well as in year 5. But what came in year 4, the value is 46,000. And what has come in year 5, the value is only 39,000, because the value of the money will keep coming down with the passage of time. CDCF is the cumulative value of DCF. CDCF is the cumulative value of DCF. That is, you start with negative 135. Start with negative 135. Negative 135 plus 0. Like we did payback cumulative values, here also we have to do cumulative values. Any doubts on this? Clear? Let me complete the payback for this, discounted payback, and then you do it for the next project. Any doubts on this? Now come down. Discounted payback equal to base year plus unrecovered discounted cash flow of base year plus unrecovered discounted cash flow of base year divided by discounted cash flow of next year divided by discounted cash flow of next year. Now go to CDCF. Is it negative in year 1? Please participate. Negative. Year 2?
Yes.
Year 3?
Yes.
Year 4?
Yes.
Year 4? No. So, your base year is year 3. Last year in which cumulative cash flow is negative? Year 3. How much negative in that year?
28?
98 divided by cash flow of next year is 46,368. It's discounted cash flow of next year, which is 46,368, not 84,000, not 18,270. Be careful about this. Cash flow of the next year. It's 3.606 years or 3 years and 7.3 months. Any doubts on this? Clear? Now repeat the same for project B. It's four years and 2.2 months. 4.19 years are 4 years and 2.2 months. Years are 4 years and 2.2 months. Done. Can we proceed? Any doubts on this? The logic remains the same here for discounted payback. Between two projects, you will select one which has lower. For if it's only one project, then you'll have to see whether it is below the target discounted payback. Like a target payback, there will be a target discounted payback also, which is given in this question. In this question, they have mentioned target discounted payback is 4 years. So target payback was 3 years and discounted payback was 4 years in this question. Any doubts till now? I'll move to the next technique then. Any doubts till now? Next, everyone done? Next is net present value technique. This is what is going to be predominantly used in an exam problem. If the problem is silent, you will end up using only NPV. If the problem tells you something, then we follow that. Otherwise, we mostly do NPV. NPV is nothing but inflow minus outflow, net present value. Inflow minus outflow. Add all inflows, deduct all outflows. That's technically called as NPV. Now, we have already done the NPV calculation. Now, what is NPV is the total of this. The total of this, because outflows are written in brackets there. Inflows are written as normal number. When you put a total of that negative 135 plus 0 plus 22 290 plus 84 plus 46 plus 39 984, the total of that is called as net present value. Inflows are 0 plus 22290 plus 80 from year 1 to year 5, whatever numbers you have, that is present value of inflows. Outflow is the initial outflow, 135,000. So all inflows minus outflow, all inflows minus outflow is going to give you NPV. We have already done the NPV. The NPV for this is 58,254. Why 58,254? That's the total of all of that. That's the total of everything. Any doubts on this? Net present value is present value of inflow minus present value of outflow. If the question only asks NPV and doesn't ask anything else, then the format which we use is year, cash flow, PVF, DCF. I stop with DCF. I don't write CDCF because DCF will give me the NPV. Clear? Any doubts on this? Now write next. Calculation of NPV. Calculation of NPV. This problem, I'll write the formula and get it. Otherwise, we just put a normal total. We don't write any formula. Calculation of NPV. NPV of project A equal to NPV of project A equal to present value of inflow minus present value of outflow. Present value of inflow minus present value of outflow. Put a total of all of those inflows. All the inflows, put a total. Everything is available in your notebook. Present value of inflow minus present value of outflow. Inflow, what is the total? No. 1 lakh. 93, 254, Present value means discounted, post discounting. 193,254 minus outflow is how much? 135,58. That is nothing but CDCF of last year. The cumulative discounted cash flow value of the last year is technically the NPV of the project, because it considers all inflow, all outflow. After that you get this 58,254. 193,254 minus 135. You get 58,254. Any doubts on that? Any doubts? Project B. Inflow minus outflow. The number is nothing but CDCF of last year, because that considers all inflow, outflow, and then the total comes. So that number is nothing but CDCF of last year. Any doubts on 34,812? Can we? Done? Okay, now please listen. Between two projects, you select a project which has higher NPV, whichever has higher NPV. And for a single project, the rule is positive vis-a-vis negative. There's no concept of target NPV and all. If you have positive NPV, go ahead with the project. If you have negative NPV, reject the project. Because positive NPV means it is generating a superior returns than what you want. That cost of capital we wrote at PVF at the rate of 16%, we wrote no. If a project is generating a positive NPV, means it is generating a return more than 16%. It indirectly means it is generating a return which is more than 16%. You want only a 16% return, but the project will give you a return more than 16%. That is what positive NPV indicates. So if we have a positive NPV, I will go ahead with the project. If I have a negative NPV, I will reject the project. Clear? Any doubts on this? Positive, go ahead. Negative, reject the project. Between two projects, obviously, which has a better one? Clear? Next technique I'll go. Next, right? Calculation of profitability index. Profitability index, OR, benefit cost ratio. OR, benefit cost ratio. Profitability index or benefit cost ratio. Now these are two names. It's a very simple thing. Listen, benefit cost ratio is equal to benefit by cost. What is benefit? Inflow. What is cost? Outflow. So there it is inflow minus outflow. Here it is inflow divided by outflow. That's the only difference. NPV is inflow minus outflow. Profitability index is inflow divided by outflow. Now the answer can be expressed in times, then you leave as it is, or in percentage, which means into 100. You can express it in times, you can also express it in percentage. When we solve a problem, we will write both. We will write 1.1 time OR 110%, 1.25 time or 125%. So we can express it in times and also in percentage. Clear? Any doubts on this? Now write benefit cost ratio equal to PV of inflow by PV of outflow into 100. PV of inflow by PV of outflow into 100. Inflow by outflow into 100. Now, all of this is already available. When you did NPV, you did inflow minus outflow. Now, take those numbers and copy here. There it was inflow minus outflow. Here it is inflow divided by outflow. 193 project B, how much it was? 2 divided by 240 into 100. What percentage? 114.5. Okay, 50% OR 1.15 times. 114.50% or 1.15 times. Any doubts on this? Clear? Can we proceed? Any doubts on this? Now, we have done 5 techniques of capital budgeting. There is one more technique called as IRR. That I'll do it later, not with this problem. We'll first get used to these 5 techniques. IRR works a little differently, not exactly the way we have done these techniques. So, IRR, I'll come back in sometime. Any doubts till now on the 5 techniques? When it comes to profitability index, for 2 projects, you will select a project which has highest profitability index because it's benefit by cost. So, I would want more benefits. For a single project, how will you decide? For a single project on profitability index, above 100%. If it's above 100%, it means benefits are more than cost. If it's above 100%, means NPV is positive. When NPV is positive, benefit cost ratio will be more than 100%. When NPV is negative, benefit cost ratio will be less than 100%. That's how your math will work. Clear? Any doubts on this? Done. Now, finally, they have said, tabulate your results and indicate which projects should be undertaken if the projects are mutually exclusive. Now, when there are multiple techniques, when they finally say tabulate the result, we'll write the technique, project A value, project B value, and project to be accepted. Payback, we may prefer project A, NPV may prefer project B, IRR may prefer project A. So, different techniques may give a different preference. If at all that conflict is there, how do you resolve? You will learn it later. As of now, we will just tabulate the results and say which project is to be selected as per every technique. 4 columns, project A, project B, project to be selected, technique, project A, project B, and project to be selected. We'll keep noting down whatever we have calculated. Start with payback. Project A, what was the payback? 2 years, 9.5 months. Project B, 3 years. I'll select project A. To be selected is project A. 2 years, 9.5 months, and 3 years, we will select project A. Then ARR, we'll write 2 times, ARR on initial. What was the ARR on initial investment for project A? 28.88%. Project B, 16%. Again, project A. ARR on initial investment, 28.88% and 16%. ARR on average investment. ARR on average investment, 57.78%, 32%, project A. In this problem, you will not see a conflict, but some questions there can be. How to resolve? I'll explain later. Discounted payback. Three years, 7.3 months, 4 years, 2.2 months, again project A. Then finally NPV and profitability index. Everywhere project A is getting selected, it's not necessary, but in this question it's happening that way. NPV is 58, 254, 34, 812, project A, 34812. Profitability index is 1. Okay, if I'm writing time, okay, 1.43 times. Project A. Any doubts on this? Done. Any doubts? Okay. Now, this problem, if it comes in an exam, I'm not going to do every technique separately and start spending time on it, because every technique needs some calculation to be done. So if at all the techniques are asked together, we will use a consolidated format. Let's now devise the format. When I did payback, what are the columns I opened? Year, cash flow, cumulative cash flow. This is for payback. When we did ARR, what are the columns we used? Year is already there. Cash flow is already there. Depreciation, PAT. Obviously, this depreciation PAT will not come for year 0. So, that we'll leave it as it is. Then, discounted payback, what you used? Year, cash flow, PVF, DCF, CDCF. So this is what I would ideally do in a single question. I'll start doing all of this together. For one project, we'll do year, cash flow, cumulative cash flow, depreciation, PAT, PVF, DCF, CDCF. After doing all of this, then I'll answer payback, ARR, your discounted payback, NPV, profitability index. All of this will be answered together. We are not going to do it separately. Just a minute. Okay, I'm not given it in the theory part. You can just note down consolidated format for calculating all techniques. Consolidated format for calculating all techniques. It's 8 columns. Consolidated format for calculating all techniques. Format for calculation of all techniques. Okay, now let's start solving a problem with all these techniques again, and we'll do it together rather than doing it individual problems, individual techniques. Go through question number 3. Okay, now coming to this question, they have given the cost details, how much are you going to spend on the machinery, life, and annual income before tax and depreciation. What does this mean? PBDT. So my first thing is I'll have to calculate the cash flow and then only start analyzing the problem. So first we'll have to get to the cash flow and then we think about the various techniques, all of that. So working note 1, calculation of cash flows. Calculation of cash flows. Particulars. Machine 1. Machine 2. Machine 1 and machine 2. What is the starting here? PBDT. Profit before depreciation and taxes. How much they have given? 345 and 455. 345 and 455. 3,45,000 and 4,55,000 less depreciation, 3,45 and 4,55 less depreciation. Any salvage value given in the question? No. So cost by 5 then. No salvage value, directly divide by 5. PBDT less depreciation. Less depreciation, directly divide by 5. PBT 1,145,000 and 155,000. PBT is 145,000 and 155,000 less tax at 30%. Less tax at 30%. PAT 30% PAT. Any doubts till PAT? Add depreciation. CFAT Any doubts on CFAT? Now, if you read the question, it says annual income before tax and depreciation, which means this amount is going to be same for all the 5 years. I have not done separately year 1, year 2, year 3, year 4, year 5. Because if at all I have to do that, I will keep writing the same thing. 345 minus 2 lakh, 145 minus 43,500. It's SLM method of depreciation. So, every year it's going to be the same amount. Even if you write, you will write 5 columns and keep copy pasting the same amount. So every year it's going to be the same amount. Let's now get to that 8 columnar format for one machine and then to the next machine. Now the question has also asked for IRR. IRR we'll ignore in today's class. I'll do it in the next class. IRR and the other techniques I'll be explaining later on. So as of now, we'll focus on those 5 techniques. Payback, discounted payback, ARR, profitability index and NPV. These are the 5 techniques we are going to do. Next, working note 2. Analysis of machine 1. Analysis of machine 1. Now before writing, let me know the columns. I may adjust certain things. So what is the first column? Year. Second column? Cash flow. Third is? Cumulative cash flow. Fourth is? I'm now going to do this depreciation and PAT wala part because this is already here. The PAT is 1,01,500. See, in this problem with PAT, we got cash flow. Last problem which we had solved, from cash flow I got PAT. So I had to do cash flow minus depreciation and get the PAT. In this question, it doesn't make any sense because PAT is something which is already available in the question. The profit is 1,01,500 every year. So the average is also 1,01,500. The average PAT is already given in the question. So, I need not again calculate it because we are not going to get anything out of it. Again, calculation is not going to get anything out of it. So, PAT, the depreciation and PAT part, I am not going to write it. So, year, cash flow, cumulative cash flow, PVF at what rate? Some rate would have been given. 8%. DCF, CDCF. Your PVF should be a 3 3-digit format, and please round off properly. If the fourth digit is more than 5 or 5, then you'll have to round off a number higher in the third digit. So it has to be only a 3-digit number, PVF. Now start filling this. Year, cash flow, PVF at 8%, DCF and CDCF. Year, cash flow, PVF. Cash flow, CCF, PVF at 8%, DCF, CDCF. The only reason why we are not writing depreciation and PAT is it's already available. I am not going to calculate anything out of it. If I was to get that number, then obviously I'll put it. But I'm not going to calculate PAT. PAT is already available. It'll start with which year? Year 0. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Starts with year 0. What's the initial outflow? 10 lakhs. Initial outflow is 10 lakhs. Now, every year you will write 301,500. That's the cash flow every year. Every year it is 301,500. The amount does not change because information is not there in the question for us to change that. Every year it is 3,01,500. The amount remains same for all the years, 3,01,500. Then in the calculator, 1 divided, is the factor value given in the question? No, so 1 divided by 1.08. 0.926. Please do proper rounding off and write. 857 794 735 681. How do you get DCF? Any doubts on PVF? What is the calculation of DCF? Cash flow into present value factor. Cash flow into present value factor. Cash flow into present value factor. You will get the DCF. Cash flow into present value factor. Now we'll have to work with these cash flows and calculate all those techniques. Any doubts on the cash flow? Let's start now. Payback equal to base year plus unrecovered cash flow of base year divided by cash flow of next year. Base year plus unrecovered cash flow of base year divided by cash flow of next year. Which is the base year? Read it carefully. 3. I'm doing payback. I'm not doing discounted payback. Year 3 plus 3 plus 95,500 divided by 3,01,500. Three years and 3.8 months. Payback 3.32 years are 3 years and 3.8 months. Any doubts on payback? Clear? Any doubts on payback? Then ARR on initial investment. We'll have to do both. ARR on initial investment. What's the formula? Average PAT divided by initial investment into 100. Average PAT by initial investment into 100. Whatever PAT you see in 1 year, that's the average, because every year it's going to remain same. So what is the average PAT? 1,01,500. 1,01,500. What's the initial investment? One lakh 1,500 divided by 10 lakh into 100. It is 10.15%. ARR on initial investment is 1,01,500 divided by 10 lakhs into 100. 10.15%. Then ARR on average investment 1,01,500 divided by 10 lakh plus 0/2, indirectly it is 5 lakh. 10 lakh, because there is no salvage value given in the question. Average is opening plus closing by 2, and closing is salvage value, and if it is not given, it is 0. Initial is 10.15%. Average is 20.30%. 10.15 and 20.30. Any doubts on average? The next one is discounted payback. Discounted payback formula is base year plus unrecovered discounted cash flow of base year divided by discounted cash flow of next year. Base year is 4 years. The answer is almost 4 years. It's 4 years and 0.1 month or 4.01 years. Four plus 1432 divided by 205322. Any doubts on this? NPV straight away answer. NPV equal to NPV is 203890. Whatever is the CDCF of the last year. It's just putting a total of your DCF, because when you put a total of DCF, your outflows are automatically deducted because you write in brackets. They are a negative number, so they are automatically deducted. So it's basically the total of DCF. Positives are added, negatives are automatically deducted there. Positive cash flows are added, negative cash flows are automatically deducted there. So the overall number is 203890. Any doubts on this? NPV is, I'm not writing a formula and all, formula doesn't make any sense. It's just the total of that. 203890. 203890. Any doubts on NPV? Clear? Profitability index, write the formula and then get the value. Present value of inflow inflow by outflow into 100. Inflow, what is the total? 1203. Your inflow is nothing but outflow plus NPV, in short, because your NPV is inflow minus outflow. So inflow has to be outflow plus NPV when you add it. One twenty point three nine percent or one point two zero times. Any doubts on this? Clear? Any doubts on machine one? Now, machine two is something which you will manage at home. So, you complete it at home and then advise the management whether which machine to be taken up. Either all the techniques will prefer machine one or all techniques are going to prefer machine two. Already cash flows are done. You just need to put it in this format. Year, cash flow, CCF, PVF at 8%, DCF and CDCF. You know the numbers and all. You just need to put it in this format and automatically all the techniques needs to be calculated. Clear? I'll proceed to question four then. Any doubts on this question? I'm not doing machine two. I leave machine two for your calculation. Any doubts? Any doubts? Go through question four. Go through question four. Okay, now coming to this question, they have given the cost of the machine. So a company is considering purchase of machine and it can either go for X or Y. All the details are given, how many years life is there. They want us to calculate few things, average rate of return and present value index. Present value index is nothing but your profitability index. They've asked only those two techniques. We'll end up doing other techniques also, whatever is possible. Their requirement is only two techniques, average rate of return and present value index method. Now, if you look at this question, they have given estimated cost of maintenance. This is an expense. Estimated cost of indirect material, again an expense. Now, you see this estimated savings in scrap, estimated savings in wages. Now, when I gave the format for calculating cash flow, the format started with revenues less all cost other than depreciation, PBDT, less depreciation, PBT, all of that was there. Now, when I buy a building, let's assume I'm going to buy a building for my own purpose. When I buy a building, it can be for two reasons. One, I let it out and earn rent. I let it out and earn rent. That is technically called as revenue enhancement. The second thing what I will do is, I was staying in a rented house, I'll stop staying in a rented house and I'll stay in my own house. When I do that, I save rent. Either I earn rent or I save rent. Both, according to capital budgeting, is same. Whether you earn extra rental income or you save an outflow of rental, both will serve the same purpose. That is basically, it's going to increase your bank balance. Either you earn more money by increasing your bank balance or reduce your outflow and increase your bank balance or increase your cash flow. So your cash flow can be increased either by revenue enhancement, that is earning rental income, or by cost reduction, that is reducing rental expenditure. From an analysis purpose, the format started with revenues. No, revenues, the other name for revenues is saving in cost. Even if it's revenue, it's a positive item, or saving in cost, that is also a positive item. So you may have a revenue in one question, some other question you may have a saving in cost. Wherever the word revenue is there, that revenue is going to be replaced with savings in cost in this question. So revenues are saving in cost, from an analysis point of view, both are same, because both will help you in increasing your cash flow. How do they increase your cash flow? My cash flow can increase by increasing the inflow or by reducing the outflow. Even if I reduce the outflow, it's an incremental cash flow for me, because net net, earlier I was to pay 1 lakh rupee, now I'm not going to pay. Because of this, my cash balance will increase by 1 lakh. Or you earn extra 1 lakh, your cash balance will increase by 1 lakh. Both serve the same purpose. So be very, very clear. Now this format which is there, I'm yet to discuss in detail on that format. I'll discuss when I get to a comprehensive question. This revenues can be otherwise called as, maybe you can just note it down in that page. Page 26, revenues can be otherwise called as savings in cost. Page 26. The term revenue can be otherwise called as savings in cost. Either they give you revenues or they give you savings in cost. Both are same from an analysis point of view. There is no difference at all in these two items. Clear? Be it revenues or be it savings in cost. Clear? Any doubts on this? Now let's start calculating the cash flow. So here, in this question, my cash flow will start with revenues. They have indirectly given the revenues in the question by giving you savings in wages, savings in scrap. All these are revenues. Savings in scrap is a revenue. Savings in wages is a revenue. Cost of supervision is all cost other than depreciation. You start with revenues, less all cost other than depreciation. In that, this indirect material, maintenance, all of that will come. Any doubts on this? Working note 1, calculation of cash flows. Calculation of cash flows. Particulars and 2 machines. Now the first item is savings in cost, and underline that. Like revenue, we have an item called as savings in cost. Revenue is one item. The similar item to a revenue is, revenue goes to the credit side of P&L. Saving in cost reduce the debit side of P&L. Both will help you in increasing your profits, increase your cash flow. So either you earn more revenue or save cost, both serve the same purpose. What is the first saving they have given? Savings in scrap. This is not salvage value, okay? This scrap is in your manufacturing process. When you use raw material, there can be some scrap which gets created. So I'm going to reduce that scrap. How much is the savings? 10,000 and 15,000. Savings in scrap. Then we have savings in wages. Savings in wages. How much? 90,000 and 120,000. Savings in cost, savings in scrap, savings in wages. Less all cost other than depreciation. Underline that. Less all cost other than depreciation. What is the expense they have given in the question? Cost of? Take a right. Cost of maintenance. Cost of maintenance. 7,000 and? 11,000. Minus 7. Minus 11. cost of maintenance -7 and -11. Then we have cost of indirect material. Cost of indirect material -6, -8. Cost of indirect material -6, -8. Then we have cost of supervision -12, -16. Now all of this has been given per annum, that's great. If they don't give per annum and they say for 5 years, then I have to divide by 5 and get it for 1 year, because all our calculation is done for a single year. All of this has been done for a single year and we repeat the same number. If the cash flows are different for different years, then the question itself will give you the figure, year one so much, year two so much. If they don't give, it means it is same. Once you deduct all of this, it's called as PBDT, profit before depreciation and taxes. PBDT, profit before depreciation and taxes. We will get PBDT at this stage, profit before depreciation and taxes. Then less depreciation, less depreciation how much depreciation? Yeah, please participate. What's the depreciation? 150,000 minus 0 divided by 5, so which is 30,000. 30,000 for the other one, it is 6 years. The second machine is 6 years, first machine is 5 years. Please take care of that. One is 5 years and the other machine is 6 years. So this is 40,000 PBT. PBT what's the tax rate? 30%. PAT. This is the most important part. Once we get this, it's more of a formality. You know what is to be done. You put it in the format, you get to the answer. The most important part is this, getting the cash flows. So the cash flow is 61,500 and 82,000. For one machine, it is 61,500. For the other machine, it is 82,000. One is 5 years and the other one is 6 years. Now, any doubts on these amounts? Can we proceed? Now, listen, the question has not asked for all the techniques. They've asked, though we will do all the techniques, but I'll tell you the short way of doing this question. Then I'll come to the all the techniques which are to be done. First, let's get to the short answer which is to be done. ARR, you know, average profit by average investment. So ARR part is something which is very clear. Average profit by average investment, or average profit by average investment, sorry, initial investment or average investment, you will get two answers. Let's write both the answers now. Now write ARR. Let's first complete whatever is required in the question and then we'll do all the techniques. ARR on average investment is equal to average PAT
by average investment. Average PAT by average investment. What is the PAT of machine X? 31. That's going to remain same. 31,500. $1,50,000 plus 0 by 2. How much? 42. We will write both the answers. Wherever the problem is silent, we will have to do both. Unless the question clearly tells ARR on which method. If it's average or initial, they have to specify. If the problem is silent, we will do both. Then machine Y. $42,000 divided by 240 plus 0 by 2. 42 by 120. How much? 35%. This is ARR on average investment. Then we'll do ARR on initial investment. We'll have to do both. Any doubts on ARR on average investment? I'm first completing what is required in the question. Then I'll anyway end up doing all the techniques. Then ARR on initial investment. ARR on initial investment.
Average PAT by initial investment into 100.
Twenty-1% and 17.5%. Any doubts on this? Clear? Now the second part which they have asked is present value index method, which is your profitability index, assuming cost of capital being 10%. Now, if a question does not ask for payback, any question where payback is not required, and if the cash flows are same for every year, we use something called as annuity way of calculation rather than a normal cash flow calculation. For example, the last problem, we had done this calculation year on year. Every year the same amount was there. If the question had not asked for payback, then I would have done it like this. Year 1 to 5, we will write it together. This is for the last question. If payback is not asked, if payback is asked, you cannot use your annuity concept. Annuity concept can come into picture in two scenarios. One, the cash flow should be same. Second, they should not ask for payback in the question. If payback is asked, we cannot do much about it. Now, in the calculator, 1 divided by 1.08, last problem, this is 1 divided by 1.08 equal to m plus, do 5 times. 1 divided by 1.08. Equal to m plus, do it 5 times. How much? No, MRC equal to M plus and final MRC. What is the number? 3.993. I'll keep it as that way. 3.993. That ideally will be the total of all of this. The total of this is 3.993. So what we could have done is, I would have written only 3.993 here. These and all will not be there. And my NPV is 203,890. NPV is 203,890. But this is possible only if payback is not asked in the question. Because for payback, you need every year cash flow. Because you need base year, CDCF of base year, all of that is needed. If payback is not asked in the question, this is what we would have done. Last question. This can help me in calculating NPV as well as profitability index. NPV is 203,890. Profitability index is 1203,890 divided by 10 lakh. 1203,890 divided by 10 lakh. If you look at this question, they have given purposefully these numbers to you. For 5 years, the annuity factor is 3.79. For 5 years is 3.79. For 6 years is 4.354. Now, how do you know it's annuity? Any factor more than 1 can be only annuity. Because all your present value factors are going to be less than 1. 1 divided by 1 point. Now, in the calculator, do 1 divided by 1.1 equal to m plus 5 times. 1 divided by 1.1 equal to m plus 5 times MRC. 3.7. If you repeat it 6 times, you will get 4.354. If you repeat it 6 times, you will get 4.354. So, wherever the cash flows are same and payback is not asked, I am again making it clear, payback is not asked. If payback is asked, that's why when I do the next part, that is all the techniques, I cannot use the short way of doing it. Because if payback is asked in the question, you will have to calculate for every year separately. So, this question, let's first complete it and then I go to all the techniques. Next, calculation of present value index or profitability index. Calculation of profitability index. Profitability index. Now listen for some time and then I'll tell you to write. Listen for some time. Machine X, it will be like this. Year, cash flow, PVF, DCF. That's all. I will not write cumulative cash flow because I'm not doing payback. I'll not write cumulative discounted cash flow because I'm not doing discounted payback. If payback was to be done, then we end up doing all the things calculation. Now, we'll write like this. Year 0, 1 to 5. Year 0, what is the outflow for machine X? How much? 1 lakh? 50,000. And every year, what amount you receive? Please participate. I'll tell you to note it down. Listen for some time. 61,500. This is going to be 1 at the rate of 10%, 3.79. Even if you do separately every year, is the answer going to be different? No, it's going to remain same. Why I'm not doing different every year separately? Because it's time consuming and I don't need it in this question. It's easier, quicker to close this. 3.79 need not be given in the question. You can calculate it. 1 divided by 1.1 equal to M plus MRC. You will calculate the factor. So this is 1,50,000. 61,500 into 3.79 is how much? 233,085. Your profitability index will be 233,085 divided by 150. And if at all they ask me NPV, then it is 83. See, NPV, profitability index, ARR can be calculated this way. If at all they ask payback and discount, IRR also this way is possible. But payback and discounted payback, you cannot use annuity factor. The reason why they gave the factor in the question is they are not asking you to calculate payback and discounted payback. So this is machine X. Then we'll repeat it for machine Y and then we'll do the detailed calculation for all. So now do machine X, calculation of profitability index.
Calculation of profitability index.
Okay, after that, you'll have to calculate the answer, sorry. Below that, get the profitability index answer.
Any doubts on the calculation? Anybody has any doubts on this?
233,085 divided by 150 into 100. 1.55 times OR 155.39% or 155.39%. 1.55 times OR 155.39%. Any doubts? Then machine Y. Year cash flow PBF at 10% and DCF. Year is what? 0, 1, 2, 6, 240, 3 lakh. 3 lakh. If at all NPV is asked, you get it with that. PI is 357,028. How much? 1.48 times OR 1.49 times R 148.76%. Any doubts on this? Clear? Anybody has any doubts on this? So this is what is asked in the question. Now let's go to the all the techniques which are to be done. Any doubts till now? Any doubts? Can we proceed? Any doubts on this? Next, computation table for all techniques. I'll do it for one machine. The balance part you can complete at home. We'll do it for one machine. Computation table for all techniques. Do we have the profits already calculated? Again, in this question, profits was calculated. Based on profits, we got the cash flow. So here also, I'm not going to have a column called as depreciation and PAT. That's an irrelevant column. So other columns, year, cash flow, cumulative cash flow, PVF, cash flow was how much? 61. What happened? 115. What is the PVA factor? 10%, no? So, 1
the NPV would remain same whether you calculate that way or you do it this way. This is only because of payback and discounted payback. Otherwise, I don't need the per year calculation. I could have straight away done it as an annuity. This will help you in calculating only payback and discounted payback. Other techniques are already done. The only purpose of creating this table is to get payback and discounted payback. Only for the purpose of payback and discounted payback, that table is going to help. All other techniques are anyway already done. Any doubts on this? Clear? I'll end the class with this. You complete the other mission and we'll continue the balance parts in the next class.